Let's go downstairs now to Dave Hodge and Lou Natty.
We found Lou in the crowd in the third period and figured that there had to be a reason for him to say hello to his fans, so we thought we'd have overtime. Lou, we're talking about the Canadians maybe changing things a little bit with the one-goal lead going to the third period. What did the Leafs do, if anything, that was different and enabled them to come back?
Well, David, in the last 10 minutes, I believe it was 10:06, I noticed on the clock, when they finally decided that every time LaFleur, Lemaire, and Schutt came out there, rather than putting Jones, Butler, and Boutet out, they put Boutet out to stay in LaFleur, but they finally went to the offense and put McDonald and Sittler out there. You're one goal down, and that's basically what they should do. If you're even strength, you probably would want to stay with the checking line, but anytime you're behind, and especially later in the game, rather than staying with the checking line, you better have some offense too. Otherwise, you just look at the clock and say, for the next minute and 20 seconds, we won't score, but maybe they won't. At that stage of the game, they finally turned to the offense, hoping that maybe Sittler and McDonald could get a goal, and eventually in a later shift, Sittler did get a goal.
Well, we want to look at that Sittler goal, and while we're doing that, I want your thoughts as to whether the Leafs should continue to play it this way.
Well, what happens here is Engblom gets caught flat-footed, and Sittler goes to the outside, and anytime you've got nothing to do with the puck, it's never wrong to put it at the net, and it deflects off LaPointe. But the key thing here was the fact that they did have the offensive line out there, Montreal did, and rather than having the left wing over on the board so the defenseman can't come deep, the defenseman was standing up, he got caught a little on the outside, he takes the man outside, but Sittler's shot goes across the front and deflects off LaPointe. And the key is that really Montreal didn't have a defensive line out there, and they shouldn't have, because they've got one of the better lines, if not the best line in the league out there at that time, but when Toronto did get the opportunity, they capitalized on it.
You know what Montreal is going to do, at least I think we know, in overtime. They'll do exactly what they did in the final 2 minutes. When it was tied, they're trying to get the winner just as soon as possible. But to get back to the Leafs strategy, do they start to play it tight again, or do they continue the way they were going?
Well, David, you'll probably see now Jones and Butler and Batet always on that Montreal line. But other than that, they've got to go for the chance to score. And just as you said earlier, in all overtime games, the majority of them in the other league, so to speak, which has overtime, they usually end within 4 minutes. The vast majority, something like 85%, were over in 4 minutes. And this year, and the Pittsburgh-Buffalo game was over in 47 seconds, and the other overtime game we've had was over quickly. So you could expect to see it end pretty quickly.
Why do you think that is, that the overtimes are being decided so
well, quickly? Late in the game, people usually are worried about making a mistake. They'd rather go for the overtime. But now, once it gets into overtime, you know that the first goal wins, and so you've got to just take any break you got and try and capitalize on it, which actually constitutes more wide-open play, and that's what eventually happens. People take a chance. They think they got a break. They don't score, and it's wide open the other end. You see some two-on-ones, three-on-twos. You do see a lot more wide-open hockey than you would in the last 10 minutes of a period when a score is one goal difference or even up.
I wouldn't say the series is going to be decided by the next goal, because if the Leafs score it, they're still not back even, and it really doesn't settle anything, although a Montreal goal and a 3-0 lead might make us say that. But I wonder just how much importance we can put on what we're going to see in the next few minutes.
Well, I'd have to say that the Leafs, you know, for all intents and purposes, are dead if they don't win this game right now. But if they do win, they're going to have a great deal of momentum and enthusiasm for tomorrow night. They could win that next game tomorrow night, and all of a sudden you'd have an even-up series. And for them, it is a do-or-die situation. For Montreal, it's not.
Let's play the name game. Pick two players, one of each team, that might score the winner.
Well, I'm going to pick Schutt for Montreal, and I got to pick Lanny McDonald for Toronto.
Well, okay, you took my Leaf away from me. I'll take Turnbull instead and go with a somewhat improbable player for Montreal, perhaps Yvon Lambert. So let's see what happens. You jot that down. I mean, you remember...
I thought you were going to go with Mondu.
No, you remember 10:06 on the clock. You ought to be able to remember those four names, and we'll see if we get lucky. Stanley Cup 79 continues in just a moment. Well, here we are again. Lou Nanny didn't have quite the opportunity to say hello to everybody in the first overtime intermission, and Howie's jumping around like Jiminy Cricket with highlights coming out his ears. So we have lots to talk about and some time to do it. Lou, I think it's the best game I've seen in, got to be several years anyway. I've often said that New Year's Eve game 75, the Canadians and the Red Army of the Soviet Union, was the best I've ever seen. And but in many ways, this can parallel it.
Well, Dave, you've got everything out there. There's been tremendous goaltending on both sides, a great number of chances for both teams, good speed, good body checking, solid hitting. No foolish penalties to speak of. Just good efforts by a lot of individuals and good teamwork. And as you would think, in an overtime, there were a lot of chances. Everybody was going for that goal, and so it led for wide-open hockey. And wide-open hockey is exciting hockey, and it's tremendously exciting when there's no goal scored and there's chances on both ends at just almost following instantaneously, and that's what we're seeing out here tonight.
Howie, we want to look at some highlights, and we hope in the confusion of getting things together that we can have them ready. But, well, let's look at them, and you talk, Howie.
Well, the highlight had to be the goaltending. It's just unbelievable here. Here, Gardner takes a pass, and watch Saginaw go to try to create a two-on-one. Gardner tried to pick the short side. It just went off the post, and like all good hockey players, he gets the rebound, throws it in front of the net. Saginaw will pick it up, and again, the Montreal defense sort of stand around and do nothing and leave Gardner home free. Look at right in front of the net, the pass right to him. Dryden just comes sprawling out using all that 6'4" length of his and makes a pretty good save. If Gardner had been able to get it upstairs, might have had a winner.
And as many chances as there were at that end, down the other one.
Well, Napier's coming in home free here, and certainly Palmateer had to guess, but Hutchinson cut him from going inside. He went outside. Watch the second effort here. This is what makes a great hockey player. He's going into the boards about 30 miles an hour, and he picks up the puck and tries to get it back out in front. But gee, great save by Palmateer. He guessed, and he guessed right.
We've seen Palmateer keep the Leafs in many games all season long, but you can watch the Canadiens for 10 straight games and never really know that Dryden has been a factor. But it's the one game like this when they say that goaltending is so important in playoffs that you can appreciate Dryden.
Well, that's right, David. He doesn't seem to be called on to make as many saves as Palmateer, but when he is, he makes the great saves. And he goes unnoticed basically because he's not as spectacular a goaltender as Palmateer. Palmateer likes to roam away from the net. He's smaller. Smaller guys seem to be moving quicker, and when you've got those kind of quick movements out there, it just creates excitement. And because of it, Palmateer's style overshadows Dryden, but tonight both goaltenders are playing equally well. And you'd have to say, in the last part of the season, for most of the games in the last 20, Palmateer was the key to the Leafs and probably playing the best goaltending of anybody in the league.
Howie, tell me if you've ever played beyond one overtime period, and then I'll tell you why I asked.
No, just one.
Well, there goes that idea.
I did a few of them.
Well, let's guess then. I mean, you go after three periods to overtime, and a lot of hockey players have been through that, but you know, you're an example. There may not be many of these guys, if any, who have been into a second overtime. What are they thinking about now, or are they just trying to get some strength, Lou?
Well, I'd say this, that a lot of them wish they weren't going into that second overtime. Probably right now they're begging for somebody to score. If you looked at Montreal defense, that's why Sittler got that chance later. They've had so much ice time, they're not moving quickly, and they're not accelerating out of there. So right now they're hoping that anybody gets a shot, take a shot. In other words, in a two-on-one situation, like the Leafs had in that first period or in the first overtime, take the shot at all time. You never know when it's going to go in, so don't wait around.
Don't get fancy, right, Howie, if you're that tired?
If the Leafs get a shot and they get it up high, Dryden has been coming out and going down before the shot has been made, and he's been lucky. Everything that's been at him has been low or on the goalpost. The first Leaf that gets one upstairs is going to go in.
There's another interesting thing to contemplate, as most fans probably know. This game would have originally been played, according to the NHL plan, on Friday night, and would have given the players a day off before game number four. Now, they're going to leave here past midnight. They're going to have to come right back here tomorrow to play a 7 o'clock game. And I would think that apart from the normal momentum you would get, the physical energy that has been drained from these teams gives the winner of this game an added advantage with no day in between.
Well, not only that, David, I think maybe you people had something to do with it. You're trying to run this game into the next game, so you only have one talent fee to pay.
Oh. Yeah, I never thought of that. We bring you along for many reasons, Lou. I'll
save you some money, you know.
I'll tell you what, the scoring chances were many, many in that overtime period. And how do you play in a second overtime based on what has happened so far? I mean, would either team, Howie, say, look, it's now time to maybe tighten up and try and wait for a break to win this, because there have been all sorts of good scoring chances that haven't won it?
Well, Roger Nielsen, the first two shifts, double shifted Sittler and McDonald, and then from then on went to all the troops and played exceptionally well. the most interesting aspect of that period, outside of the fact the goaltending was super, that Lafleur, Schutt, and Lemaire just didn't seem to handle the puck. And if they're going to get a winning goal, the odds are it's going to have to come from them. So who's ever looking after Lemaire and Schutt? Schutt hasn't touched the puck all night, has he?
Well, he didn't play the last 8 minutes or 10 minutes of that overtime. I think he got hurt in one of those checks too, so they put Gainey out there. And Schutt had the best chance early for Montreal. He deflected that shot by Savard, and a great save. And after that, they start putting Gainey out there, and they're putting Lafleur with everyone. And as you say, there was a double shifting on Toronto's side, just as well as on Montreal. And right now, you got to go with your best, because they're the most proficient, and hope that they can do it.
What sort of balance did you see in the Leaf lineup between the so-called checkers and the scorers?
Well, Dave Early, he started out with Jones against Lafleur's line, but right after they had a face-off deep in the Leaf zone, he went right back to Sittler and McDonald, along with Boutette against Lafleur's line. Kept that up for the majority of the overtime period until, I'd say, the last 6 or 7 minutes. And every now and then, he'd give Jones' line a shift against Lafleur's line, basically because Lafleur's got so much stamina, he's out there at all times. He wears out one checker. So Roger, at that time, was going to his strength. He was going to... If our best guys get the opportunity, they'll score. If their best get the opportunity, they'll score. But we're going to let the scorers get the most ice time, and he did that all the way along.
I haven't got a list of the players we picked to win it in overtime. We haven't asked you. However, you get two players off the top of your head, one on either team?
Yeah, I would take Gardner and Lafleur.
Nobody's picked Lafleur, I don't think.
Yeah,
and nobody's picked Gardner.
Did.
Okay, all right.
That's right, but Gardner had the chances,
yeah,
too, and he's a good goal scorer. And right now I'm thinking he's seen himself, give me that one chance again, because he'll put it away.
Boy, it's going to be tough when it comes time to pick three stars. I would say almost impossible in this game. We talk about the goalies, the defensemen, the forwards. What a hockey game, and we hope you're enjoying it as much as we are, and there's no way you can get drowsy watching this one. Stay with us. Brian McFarlane and Gary Dornhofer are wide awake and ready to go with their comments.